He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Over the past few tutorials, we've been covering several viruses that have been responsible for outbreaks in the 21st century, so let's continue with another. In 2003, there was a mysterious respiratory disease spreading rapidly around the world. The World Health Organization issued a global alert for a severe form of pneumonia with unknown origin after significant outbreaks were reported in China, Vietnam, and Hong Kong. They called the disease Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome, or SARS, and scientists, public health officials, and everyone in between worked closely together to track down what was causing it. They soon figured out that SARS was caused by a novel coronavirus, which they decided to call SARS coronavirus, abbreviated thusly. Before we talk more about SARS, though, let's talk about what we had already known about coronaviruses in general, before this one came onto the scene. First of all, coronaviruses are the second most prevalent cause of the common cold, coming in after rhinoviruses, which we covered earlier in the series. Coronaviruses get their name from their crown-like shape, as they are spherical and have protein spikes poking out all around the surface of the virion. Zooming in a bit more, coronavirus particles have a protein coat called the capsid, which protects the genetic material, then an additional envelope of lipids surrounding the nucleocapsid. Coronaviruses have the longest positive sense RNA genome among viruses, part of which encodes four glycoproteins that are important for their success. These are spike, membrane, envelope, and nucleocapsid glycoproteins, abbreviated as S, M, E, and N, respectively. The halo of spikes on the spherical surface of the virion gives the virus its ability to survive in places like the gastrointestinal tract. Coronaviruses typically infect epithelial cells in the respiratory tract, and they stay localized in the upper respiratory tract because it has the optimal temperature for viral growth. The virus is most likely spread by aerosols and large droplets, like from a sneeze, and causes colds very similar to that of rhinoviruses. So even though the SARS coronavirus is in the same family as coronaviruses we had already known about, scientists compared their genomes and found SARS coronavirus to be only moderately related to other known coronaviruses. This means that we understand what at least some of the genes in this virus are doing, but there are portions that need to be studied further. The outer spikes on SARS coronavirus attach to receptors on host cells called ACE2, or angiotensin-converting enzyme 2. After binding on the surface, both the ACE2 receptor and the virion are internalized into the host cell, where it makes many copies of the virus to then attack more cells. Compared to all the coronaviruses we know about, SARS coronavirus infection usually causes severe symptoms related to the lower respiratory tract. When someone catches SARS, either through direct contact or by droplet or airborne routes, the patient typically has flu-like symptoms at first, such as fever, chills, malaise, and a cough. From there, about 70% of cases have a persistent fever or shortness of breath, while the other 30% start to improve after the first week. For those with persistent infection, about 20 to 30% of patients require intensive treatment like a ventilator, and severe cases can come on rapidly, progressing from cough to serious respiratory distress requiring intensive care. The mortality rate averages to about 10% of SARS cases overall, and even though SARS coronavirus is most likely transmitted in respiratory droplets, it is also present in sweat, urine, and feces. Since coronaviruses have been historically known to primarily cause mild upper respiratory tract infections, the outbreak of SARS was definitely a shock. The 2003 pandemic taught us that it's possible for coronaviruses to encode elements that can lead to severe disease outcomes, especially in the elderly. Now we know that some coronaviruses can cause severe lower respiratory tract infections in very young people, very old people, and everywhere in between. And it truly put coronaviruses on the map as something to spend time and money researching so that we can better understand them. When it comes to diagnosing a case of SARS, there are several lab tests that can be done, and strict quarantine is usually enforced to make sure a suspected case doesn't spread. For those that have confirmed cases of SARS, the treatment is the same as any serious case of pneumonia, except for maybe some extra safety precautions for the healthcare workers. There isn't a vaccine or approved antiviral treatment for SARS as of now, but a few are in the works. And really, since the initial global incident in 2003, there have only been a few instances of SARS in the world, all of which were contained and most of which were acquired in a laboratory setting. The best way to protect yourself against SARS is to pay attention to the news and check the CDC or WHO website.
Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.